This is Mike Cavanaugh with HIVHERO.ORG, providing the latest from the International AIDS Conference in Amsterdam.
The fight against AIDS is not, and must never be, a fight against other people. It's a fight of human beings against a virus.
Excellencies, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, welcome to AIDS 2018. I am honored to be your master of ceremonies tonight. It is a privilege to stand here in Amsterdam this evening, following in the footsteps of our colleagues from 1992. Thank you for being part of a fight that stretches back more than 30 years. The world doesn't thank you enough for the work that you do, so I want to make sure you hear it very clearly, right now, right up front. Thank you. Thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you, and thank you. Before we get started, though, I also want to acknowledge the thousands of people that are watching and engaging from afar, and I'm going to need your help with that. I want everyone in the room to say, welcome to AIDS 2018 on the count of three. Can you help me out when we do that? Yeah. Welcome to AIDS 2018. Ready? One, two, three. I love that. That was great. What a way to begin an evening. Hi, my name's Omar Sherif Jr. and I'm best known for being actor Omar Sharif's grandson. Which for me means one thing, and that's a lifetime of feeling inadequate. That's okay. Seriously though, growing up a Sharif in Egypt, that's kind of like being born a Kennedy, or from some angles, more of a Kardashian. Maybe. The point I'm trying to make is that I grew up very privileged. I got to be an actor from a young age, a spokesperson for top brands, and even an underwear model. I've since rediscovered carbohydrates, so that's no longer in my cards. But in 2012, all of that changed. At the height of the Arab Spring, I became the first Arabic public figure to come out openly as gay. Question the government's commitment to basic human rights. My announcement immediately went viral and I was met with widespread criticism, threats of violence, and death threats. And I think a lot of people in this room know exactly how that feels. I left the country and I have not been home since. In my region of the world, the Middle East and North Africa, talking about LGBTQ issues and certainly talking about HIV are incredibly risky. Just starting the conversation takes courage. And that's why I'm so pleased to be here tonight as an ambassador for the Elizabeth Taylor AIDS Foundation, along with all of you at the front line of the fight against HIV. The world doesn't thank you enough for all that you do, and I want to make sure that you hear it very clearly from all of us across the Middle East, North Africa, and around the world, from all of us who are silenced by fear, by repression, and by stigma. Thank you. Thank you, thank you, thank you.
Summer's Day at the Beers near Christopher Street. I can hardly describe what an effect my HIV diagnosis had on me at the age of 21, knowing there was no future for people living with HIV and AIDS back then. The only perspective was getting sick, deteriorating, and dying painfully with no treatment and no cure. From that moment onwards, I learned about society's stigma, exclusion, discrimination, anger, hate, and fear towards those living with HIV and AIDS. I saw my communities fighting day by day with no hope. We lived without a notion of tomorrow or the future. Now, see me at the age of 48, standing here in front of you. longtime survivor, an HIV and transsexual activist. It's an enormous honor and an important momentum for me and all the communities I represent to welcome you all here together with our Minister of Foreign Trade and Development, Mrs. Kaag, at the opening of the 22nd International AIDS Conference in Amsterdam. We need the undetectable is untransmittable, or USU, message to become standard knowledge worldwide. Stigma and self-stigma of people living with HIV. It will save lives, it will reduce suicides and murders on trans sex workers especially. Please give all your wisdom, knowledge and power in the coming days to contribute to the fight against HIV and AIDS and to change our narratives. Together we can beat the virus, and together we can shape the future for our generations to come. Thank you.
Can you believe it's been 2 years since the closing of AIDS 2016 in Durban, and I am so happy and honored to join you once again. I'm energized having spent this past weekend surrounded by hundreds of terrific young people who are here in force for AIDS 2018. After 2 days with them, I'd like to share one thing I've learned. For colleagues who, like me, are feeling somewhat worn out by the bleak state of our global politics, I would say now is the time to snap out of it. The next generation is motivated and mobilized, and they have no time for pessimism or negativism.
Vision without action is merely daydreaming.
But vision with action can change the world. I hope in the next 4 days at this conference, your hearts will be stirred, your minds expanded, and as you return home, AIDS 2018 will be the turning point for you when you decided, each one of you, to roll up your sleeves and change your world.
All that we do in responding to the epidemic at its core not only has to be and to remain firmly rooted in science and a generation of evidence-based knowledge, but it must also include the hands-on involvement of affected and at-risk communities and a translation of knowledge into action jointly with these same communities and with policymakers. Going back in history, shining and effective examples in our country were the introduction of needle exchange for people who used drugs already in the early 1980s, and the rapid introduction in 1996 of HIV protease inhibitors as part of what we then called ART, by a very personal decision to do the right thing and subsidize this novel and life-saving treatment by then Minister of Health, Els Borst.
But you didn't forgive the tragic moments that struck me like lightning strikes a ship. The moments which I could not have dealt with, the moments in which I just couldn't get no grip.
Because we are underfunding prevention efforts and sexuality education. And because most of the programs for young people that receive funding are actually being developed by adults, aging people like me. So, what we need is we must include young women in the design, and young women and adolescent girls in the design and rollout of new prevention efforts. And at the same time, also make sure that we include young men and boys.
Today I'm not standing up here on the stage to share details of my personal story. I'm here to use the attention I get and to direct it to this disease and to help make it just normal to talk about it. Today, I feel fitter, more beautiful, and stronger than ever before. In a sense, this is also because I faced my greatest fear and was able to talk about it. That is the message that I wish to convey. Yes, I live in a region of this planet where we have access best and most advanced medication available. People living with HIV and getting treatment can live just as long a life as those who are negative. You can touch us, you can kiss us, you can love us just as you would anyone else. Well, I think it's safe to say that we wouldn't be where we are today without a courageous once graced his stage in 1992 and shared a similar message of compassion, Dame Elizabeth Taylor. You heard the words earlier tonight, but they are worth repeating. The fight against AIDS is not and must never be the fight against other people. It is the fight of human beings against the virus. Yes, yes, a thousand times, yes.
When our grandmother stood here in Amsterdam at the 1992 International AIDS Conference, she did not expect that my cousins, Layla and Naomi and I, would be here 26 years later, advocating for many of the same issues she fought for then. Although the years, the decades, have grown in number, the urgent fight for social justice and human rights around the world has maintained day after day. Our grandmother gave her voice to a reality that wasn't getting the attention it deserved in 1992. And it is our humble honor to continue that legacy tonight alongside everyone here this evening.
Our families and communities were dying all around us. We were likely to die ourselves. There was little support for us, rejection, and no antiretroviral. But we were determined, in whatever time we had, to work together to make a difference. In the years that have followed, women living with HIV in all our magnificent global diversity became agents for incredible change. We created support groups where none existed. We became champions for legal and policy change in our countries. We fought hard alongside other community leaders for access to affordable antiretroviral therapy for everyone, no matter where in the world they lived. HIV has taught us that, irrespective of where we come from, we are all equal and all deserve dignity, respect, and the right to life.
As a young person coming from Middle East North Africa, it's important to mention that last week, UNAIDS launched their report, Miles to Go, and the results were shocking to our region, as it mentioned that there is a rise in new infections by 25%. Taking into account that our region of the world still until today imposes travel restrictions against HIV. This attack on our dignity is also an attack on our hopes and dreams. On the other hand, I can tell you that today we are stronger than ever. Young people are finding their voices, demanding their needs all over the world, speaking up and up on panel, like we have seen at the Youth Day Conference and like we will see at the coming days of the main conference.
There is a bridge in Honduras that was originally built to withstand anything. And I think it is a perfect metaphor for the HIV response today. It is a bridge that survived the odds, and when a hurricane came, the bridge withstood the winds. However, the river moved. Too often, in the HIV response,